Welcome back. Legend is a word that's often bandied about and not always justified. But if ever there was a dead set legend, it's Barnsley. Born in Scotland, raised in Adelaide, adored across the country, he's been belting out hits since the early 70s. And while he won fame and notoriety as the frontman of Cold Chisel, it's now 30 years since the band split and Jimmy went solo. The hell-raising days may be over for this 58-year-old father of seven and grandfather of eight, but as Carl Stefanovic found out, Barnsley is showing no signs of slowing down.
Even on a midwinter's night in Darwin, it's still a very balmy 25 degrees. But what's really warming up is this. It might be unorthodox preparation, but Jimmy's band isn't fazed because the band is also his family. His son Jackie, daughter Mahalia, and of course Jane, Jimmy's wife of 33 years.
Family affair here tonight.
It is, it's great, isn't it?
Grandkids are here, the your wife's here. Cheap wine and a 3-day
roll. Yeah, cheap wine and a 3-day roll. 5,000 fans have come along to see and hear what Jimmy does best. It's been this way since Mahalia was born.
Let's go sing a few songs.
You're in.
He was off on the pageant.
You know, when they were kids, we didn't leave them behind. Or, you know, we did everything with them.
The family that works and plays together.
We all love food, we all love to make music, and yeah. We're very outspoken.
Is why Sunday lunch at the Barnes's is so entertaining.
The thing is, rock bands can just break up, but families...
Families are forever. Yeah, families are forever.
You do both. Well, that's got to complicate things.
So that gets difficult sometimes.
Yes, I get fired all the time. I get fired more than anyone.
Stand back, she's got a knife.
And I just quit.
I've never been fired.
Yeah, you haven't joined the band yet.
You're a sucker.
I'm an independent contractor who's never been fired.
You're fired, get out of here. do the onions, because Carl wants us to cry.
At the centre of it all is Jane and Jimmy.
Oh, really, it's been a tough life, Carl.
He's my idol. He's my hero. He's my prince, there's no doubt. You know.
How lucky am I, eh?
See, this is a love story.
It is a love story. I look back on, there's been so many wild, hard, good, bad, and I just keep thinking how lucky and how blessed I am to have spent, you know, most of my life with this girl. You know, every day she just looks, she's like an angel. And I want to spend my, you know, spend my life with her.
Well, you've got us on a good week.
Come back next week, I'll probably see that bloody woman. I'm going to kill
Let's go, Ollie.
But I think we've got to plant a few big greens.
On the face of it, you would be hard-pressed to find a more unlikely couple. There's the boozing, brawling Scot from the mean streets of outer Adelaide and the Thai-born daughter of an Aussie diplomat, highly educated and certainly sophisticated.
See?
You remember the date of when you first
met? The minute I seen her. November the 11th, 1979, 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Walked into this hotel, a bunch of friends, and there across the room was the most beautiful girl I've ever seen in my life.
What makes you, who's on this very different path, decide, I'm going after this lead singer of Cold Chisel, and how'd that go down at home?
Well, you see, I didn't even know who they were.
She
knew of us a couple of things, but she didn't.
I'll tell you what, the extent of what I knew, my girlfriends used to say, oh, look at this record cover. You know, it was Breakfast at Sweethearts.
Which one would you go for?
Which one did you pick? And I'm going, do I really have to pick? They look a bit grubby.
Maybe a little grubby, but when Jane met Jimmy in 1979, Cold Chisel was the biggest rock band in Australia. Well, the last plane out of Sydney's almost gone. You know, the last plane out of Sydney's almost gone.
They were hard rocking boys who played pubs and partied harder than anyone else in the country. You know the last plane out of Sydney's almost gone. Colt Chisel has been described as somewhere between a robust democracy and cage fighting.
Yeah, yeah. Closer to cage fighting, probably.
Was it that bad?
No, no. You know what? No, it was the tension. See, people would come see Colt Chisel because something's going to happen. They'd, you know, we'd punch each other on stage, we'd bloody, I'd storm off, there'd be things falling apart, you know, it was chaos, and it was like just that nervous tension, pulling and pushing all the time. And sometimes it would lock in really tight, and then boom, it would splinter again, and that tension was really what made it exciting, and that's what makes rock and roll. We shared some history,
this town and I. To truly understand Jimmy, you need to see where he came from.
This was where I first touched Australia. This is like home for me.
Yeah. Adelaide in 1960 was a pretty quiet town. But for Jimmy, recently arrived aboard the SS Strathnaver with his family from Glasgow, it was like paradise. After all this time, you boys
look just the same. Me and the rest of my brothers and sisters went outside and there's trees, there's bloody magpies, there's kangaroos, you know, and we just thought we were in heaven. You know, suddenly, you know, grass to play football on instead of concrete, you know, it was really good.
When did you start singing and do you remember why?
I always sang. I was in the choir for years. I sang in church groups. I just sang anywhere I could go.
A choir boy?
I was a choir boy until I was about 12 or 13 and then I wouldn't blend anymore.
You could have been a man of God.
No, yes.
How scary a thought is
that? Well, I've spent many a night on my knees going, Jesus. So, I've thought about it, yeah.
By the 70s, the Adelaide docks is where Jimmy and the boys from Chisel would hang out. And don't think that you can push me too far. It was the centre of their universe.
You always had your mates, you always had something to eat, you always had somewhere to play, you could always get a drink. If you wanted, you could have a fight, you know, plenty of good-looking chicks.
And it all happened here, the Largs Pier Hotel. 40 years ago, it was a regular slaughterhouse.
The Beast.
There used to be a bouncer here called The Beast.
Yeah, really?
Really. I used to come and watch him for entertainment.
What did it do for Chisel in terms of music? What did it teach you?
We came here, and they were a tough audience, you know. If they didn't like you, they'd throw bottles at you. Mm. And we started filling this room. It was about 800,000 people. We started filling it up, and then it got to the point where we'd go and play other venues, and all the punters from here would come with us. This was our core audience. So this is where Colt Chisel started.
Breakfast at Seed Hall. The lifestyle revolved around late nights, drugs and booze. Breakfast at Seed Hall. When Jimmy was on stage with Chisel, he would drink at least 2 bottles of vodka a night.
Oh, I'd drink anything that was nailed down. I used to do, you know, cheap speed in the old days, and like every rock and roll band in the world, you read about the Beatles, it was all really cheap stuff just to keep you going so you could get to the next gig and perform. It wasn't even about getting high. It was just sort of, okay, can I make this? Yes.
Inevitably and thankfully, there was rehab. Four walls, wash
basin, prison bed. I'm not afraid to go out and get help. You know, if anything,
it's
I can
important.
Get help to be a better person, to be a better father, better husband. You know, if somebody can give me help to do it, I'll go and get it, you know. Bon appetit, guys. Dig in.
Well, is there anything that you regret?
Didn't do enough.
Look at all these amazing kids. How can you?
I can regret anything. Look at
we learned a lot from it.
This is a consequence of the wild days.
Yeah,
so
look at him.
How can we complain?
Staring us in the face.
Right here, not going away.
Jimmy's eldest son is David Campbell from a previous relationship. And in recent years, Jimmy also discovered he had two daughters he didn't know about, Amanda Bennett and Megan Torzen, both of whom are in their mid-30s. Can you run me through the family tree?
All right, because it grows, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the best thing. So it used to be, I used to be the oldest.
Yeah.
And that was great. It was a fantastic position. I had a lot of extra confidence from that. And then Megan came along and she's, I think she's 3 or 6 months older than me. So it goes Megan now and then me, then Amanda, Mahalia, Mahalia, EJ, Jackie, Ellie. So just, that's how it goes.
That's it, though, isn't it? There's no one else out there.
I should bloody hope so. This will can't take much more.
It was like Samson.
How's your relationship with him now?
Oh, it's brilliant.
Is it?
Oh, no, we have a great time. We have a good laugh, same sense of humour. We sing together. You know, he's a great granddad.
Jane seems to me that she's got a wonderful love about her.
Oh, yeah, she's the backbone. She's the thing that holds us all together. I mean, I think that this... It wouldn't be the same without her.
David is closer to Jane probably than me. You know? She's a great woman. I mean, when I found out later on about my other two daughters, Jane was really instrumental in making that not only comfortable for me, but comfortable for them and for the family. It was a real, pretty exceptional, not only to accept that, but to embrace it as well as she did. It was
Jane?
Pretty spectacular.
Well, my Australian father, my mother remarried to an Australian, young Australian, when he was a diplomat in Bangkok. And he came back with my mum, with a Thai divorcee and three children, to Canberra in the early 60s and raised us. That's my first glimpse of love, you see. Raised us like his own. So it was not difficult for me to feel that it was right, especially when I met Megan, Amanda, David. They're just...
They're special people, you know?
To celebrate an extraordinary 30 years as a solo artist, Jimmy has re-recorded many of his greatest hits, again enlisting the family and good mate Keith Urban. I wanna have a good time tonight. A rock and roll music gonna play all night. Come on, baby, it won't take long. I only take a minute just to sing my song. And rolling around, it's gonna be right, Jimmy. Let me ask this: how long can you keep going?
I think I've got a long time left of me. Especially as healthy as I am now, I'm ready to go for another 30 years. But I don't want to end up being on stage and being a parody of myself. And I'll say people want to come and see me as long as they like what I'm doing, whether it's, it's hard rock or whether it's, bloody soul or whether it's, ballads. As long as they enjoy it, come along. If they don't, then I'll eventually, I guess, if there's nobody there, I'll stop.
These days, this 58-year-old father of 7 and grandfather of 8 is happiest with Jane and their ever-expanding musical family. Is this the way it's gonna be
forever now? My thing is that as long as you're improving, in growing, you're living, As long as I'm improving as a singer as a person, as a father, as a husband, as a human being, I'm going to be a better person and I'll be a happy person if I do that.